Hey, brothers and sisters, I'm back. I just took a little little taste there of some fluids there. Let's see. I wanted to make a second video. Excuse me. I wanted to talk about just some comparisons that the Lord's been showing me. Now, let's look at this one. This is what I want to talk about in the last video, but the Lord arrested me and started having me preach. So I want to do a little teaching. Okay. Revelation chapter 5, Jesus has the scroll with seven seals on it. King James says book, but it's actually a scroll. Then that book's then really that scroll. And there's seven seals on there, right? The first four seals are the four horsemen of the apocalypse. We're talking about the four blood moons now. Let's just roll that in around in our mind. Now, later on, this is what I want to tell you. I want to tell you something about the book of Revelation. That the Lord is really, I mean, I knew this before, but the Lord just kind of illuminated a little bit better in my mind. Now, in Revelation 5, Jesus has the thing, the scroll. He opens up the seven seals, like I said. Then in Revelation 10, a strong angel, listen to this, there's a strong angel who stands on the land and the sea, okay? And he gives that scroll, a open scroll, it's already been opened, to John. And he tells him to eat it, and he says, you know, you must prophesy again to many nations, tongues. Now what I believe, I want to say this, I believe that after he eats that scroll, he begins to give the details. And I've always known this, but never saw this part before. The book of Revelation is, you know, just like when in Genesis, you know, the devil's people who are scholars will tell you that there's two books and then an unknown book. There's text Y and Z or whatever, and then an unknown text. They claim that Genesis is made out of three texts. Because it kind of repeats the story. If you listen, read Genesis, it talks about God created man and all that stuff. And then in Genesis chapter 3, it goes back and mentions that God created them male and female. So the devil's people will say that there's two different texts or three different texts mixed together. That's how we got the, you know, the Torah. That's what they'll tell you. But in reality, the way God does things, he will give you an outline and then go back in and fill in the details. I think this is going to be a good video that people appreciate. Those of you who want to know how to study the Bible. Now, like I said, I've known this before. I haven't seen this showing of it in the text. So in Genesis, it starts out giving just an overview, and then they go back and get into the detail about Adam and Eve and the fall and all that. And you can see that. And then even in the prophets and Isaiah and all that, if you read a verse or Proverbs, it'll say the same thing twice, but in a different way. It'll say, I can't think of any off the top of my head. There's hundreds or thousands of examples in Hebrew idioms where it will be like, you know, God makes the sun to shine. I'm making this up, you know. God makes the sun to shine, and God makes it a cloudless day, you know, or he makes it a cloudless day. So it's kind of repeating, but in a different way. God makes the sun to shine, but he makes a cloudless day. So it's kind of repeating, even there's deeper meanings and all that, and that thing I just said is not in the Bible. My mind is empty on thinking of one. There's hundreds of those. Anyway, so here is what I'm saying. That in the seals, the seven seals is kind of overview of the whole tribulation period. And then within that, then after he eats the scroll, I'm saying that scroll that John eats, the open scroll, is the same scroll that the Lord has already opened in Revelation chapter 5. Revelation chapter 10, he eats the scroll, and then he goes back and prophesies again to many nations, tongues, and peoples. Then he goes and gives the details about the beast and all that, right? He lays out all the details all the way up to Revelation chapter 18. That's what I'm saying. That's the details of what happened during the seals. So it's happened simultaneously. It's like all of the trumpets and bowls or whatever is the detail out of the seals. Do you see what I'm saying? It's overlap. It's not in direct chronological order. You know, people think, one person I mentioned before in the video, that it's not exact chronological order. And then someone tried to, you know, someone messaged me and said, you think that that the tribulation is already partly I don't know what they said, but that's not what I was saying. I'm saying that there's things in the book of Revelation that are happening simultaneously during the tribulation. In other words, I'm saying that while the seals are being opened, all these other things are happening. All these other things, you know, like seal number one, you know, and I can go into detail in another video. Seal number one, there's a rider on a white horse, and he's got a bow but no arrows and all that. He goes out to conquer. Okay, that's the Antichrist, which deals in Revelation chapter 13. When Paul goes into detail, he says, I see a beast rise out of the sea. Okay, that's the Antichrist. The beast that rises up off the land is the false prophet. The Bible goes on to tell us. The second beast. Now, there's this wacky upside down reader who thinks that Obama is the second beast, the false prophet. Can you imagine the president of the United States being a false prophet? That doesn't make any sense. Possibly a world leader could be the Antichrist, of course. But the false prophet, that's a religious leader. Leading the one world religion. Let me continue on here. Now, something else the Lord just showed me. The giant angel in Revelation 10. The Lord used to try to show me stuff in this for a year, and I could never get it. The Lord kept quickening my spirit to read this text. A dozen times, or two dozen times. I never could focus enough to get it, I guess. But the giant has 1 foot on the land and 1 foot on the sea. Now, later on, when we see the beast rise, the first beast rises out of the sea, which is the Sea of Nations. In biblical interpretation, the Bible interprets itself. Not just a revelation, but the whole Bible. The Lord has consistent themes, like stars represents angels. In the beginning of Revelation, it tells us that the 7 stars in the hands of the Lord represent angels. But all through the Bible, even Satan is a star that fell from heaven. Stars that fall are fallen angels. A star that came down is a holy angel. Okay, so the one who opens the bottomless pit, it says, I saw a star fall from heaven, not come descend from heaven, fall from heaven. So that's not a holy angel that opened up the pit, but the dragon. I assume it's probably Satan who opens up the pit and lets out Abaddon or Apollyon and his army. I believe Apollyon is a spirit that will possess the beast, because he is called the beast that comes out of the bottomless pit. If you study, that's really the Antichrist, is actually the fallen angel Apollyon, or a man who becomes possessed by that at mid-trib when he has a deadly wound but rises again. That's the standard theory. The second part I just told you is standard evangelical, theological interpretation of the meaning, is that as a man who makes a peace treaty, he's going along, he gets killed, like assassinated, but somehow he comes back to life. He appears as if he's killed, he comes back to life. Mid-trib, then he becomes possessed by Apollyon. Then he declares himself to be God when he goes and does the abomination that causes desolation, when he goes into the rebuilt temple there in Jerusalem mid-trib. That is standard theological interpretation. There's no way about this foolishness on YouTube that the abomination that causes desolation is when someone takes the mark of the beast. Now that is a secondary and a metaphoric way of describing that. But if I'm a human walking this earth and I'm not born again and then I take the mark, I'm not a holy place. Someone's spirit would be holy when it's filled with the Holy Spirit. And people, according to this system of wacky non-theologian made doctrine, this serpent seed doctrine, is that there's people walking the earth who are half Nephilim right now. 90% of the people on earth are half devil. If you're a half devil, you're a beast. Beasts can't get saved. That's why I said what I believe, my opinion, when someone takes the mark, their DNA will change. They will become a Nephilim. They will become a Gibor, like Nimrod became a mighty hunter. He became a Gibor. He became like the Nephilim. His DNA was changed somehow. By the fallen angels did that in those days when they tried to build a kingdom of heaven. Nimrod is the greatest type of the Antichrist. And that's when you want to know what the Antichrist is going to do, look what Nimrod did. Look what Hitler did. You look at all these people, you see these types, Napoleon, these guys, they wanted a one world government. They wanted to control the world. Hitler talked about his 1,000-year Reich, mocking the 1,000-year reign of Christ. All these things. He tattooed the Jews. All kinds of things that point us to and the people that knew Hitler, that really knew Hitler, that were normal people, they said Hitler was demon-possessed. He was a very evil man. And I'm sure he was demon-possessed. Obviously. Obviously. If there's anyone walking the earth that was demon-possessed, in modern history, Hitler is a prime example. Even though there's lots of more people that are influenced and demonized, and lots of your world leaders are demonized and evil people. But, the standout ones, Hitler, Mao Zedong, these kind of people. Anyway, Kim Il-un fed his uncle to dogs to be eaten and all kinds of stuff. Let's see. So the giant angel stood on the earth and the sea. And now some people say that this giant angel is the Lord Jesus Christ because he had a rainbow around his head and all these things. It says it gives him like he's God. But then other people say, I'm talking about not, you know, these special people on YouTube. I'm talking about real theologians. A real theologian. A theologian is someone with a doctorate in theology. Not someone on YouTube says they're a theologian who does the news or any other thing like that. But theologians say that it's either the Archangel Michael or the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And so that's a debate, and I'm not sure. And it's and at this moment, it's not really the most important thing to know. It's just a side note. The important thing to know is we see the imagery. We see the imagery. The rainbow around his head, of course, I didn't write all this down. I'm looking at the little bit of notes I did write about the giant angel. Rainbow around his head represents God as a covenant-keeping God. His feet, one on the land, one on the sea, God has dominion over the whole earth. But I do believe there's a secondary reference. You know, the sea of nations, the earth is Israel. God will, you know, unite the Gentiles and the Israel and make one new man. Of course, that's the bride that we have. And the tribulation saints will also be one new man. Okay. Now, let me go on to these other things. I want to talk about the four blood moons because that's the Lord. Like I said, I haven't made any mention about the blood moons, and the Lord has corrected me on that and told me, hey, there's something to this, okay? And it's not my inclination was against the blood moons meaning anything, okay? All right. But the Lord showed me that there's something to this, that it is a big road sign, maybe the biggest in our lifetimes. Okay. Next to the 1967, the Six-Day War, I guess was the last one, and now this. Not the blood moons themselves, but the result, the Six-Day War. Anyway, so this is the things I just wanted to add to this. There's lots more than this, and I'll throw this out there to people to hear this. Okay, there's someone messaged me, and I had thought about this a long time ago and just dismissed it. I think about these things and just let it go on through my mind. There's the four horsemen of the apocalypse, as I've already mentioned. You know, it's the first four seals that the Lord opens. You know, there's the white horse, the Antichrist, the red horse, war, the black horse, death, and whatever it is. Is it famine? And the last one is death and hell following after him and all this. The dapple horse or green horse, whatever. Anyway, so there's the four blood moons. And there is the four horsemen. Even though, like I made in the comment on the last video, I do not believe, of course, that the tribulation has begun. None of the seals have been opened, even though they're close to it. I believe that these four blood moons are like, there'll be birth pains. There'll be shadows and types of the four horsemen in these four blood moons. But I believe that within these, and I believe this is really, I'm just going to speculate, possibly. Let me just say possibly the inspiration of the Lord. Not 100% sure. You know, and postulating on what I've already been saying, that within those four birth pain shadow events would come the actual seals would begin during this time period. Just as those other things would begin in the middle of the seals. The seven seals actually covers the time of the tribulation or a huge part of it. Maybe some people say the first half of the tribulation. It's been a while since I studied what all the theologians said. I'm just going by memory what I looked at before. Anyway, and it's always good to go back and review what experts say as a base. As I mentioned in the last video, we don't build scaffolding off of what somebody else says. We go back to the Word. But we look what other people say, like St. Augustine or whomever. Irenaeus was a good one. We read Irenaeus against heresies, where we see the first written reference to the rapture, Irenaeus, book 4, against heresies, was a disciple of Polycarp, who was a disciple of John, who wrote Revelation. And he said there would be a pre-tribulation rapture. And that was in less than 200 A.D. Just for all you, you know, in 1830, a retarded girl and William Darby made it up. That's what the pre-trib rapture haters say, and they are haters of a doctrine of the Lord. Anyway, there's the four horsemen of the apocalypse. I just mentioned it. There's the four chariots with four horses going to the four corners of the earth from the four winds, north, south, east, and west, from Zechariah. Okay. And then there's the four points, of course, of God's creation. And four is the number referred to earth, north, south, east, and west, right? The four corners of the earth. And then there's the four living creatures around the throne of God. As a matter of fact, our heart has four chambers. I've done a video about that a couple of times. Brothers and sisters, there's 24 elders around the throne of God. And there's 24 ribs. There's four chambers in our heart. There's the four living creatures under the throne of God. Of course, the Lord sits on the throne of our heart when we're born again Christian. We are a temple of God. Now, I'm not equating like these other people, as I mentioned. They're running with, you know, it's not man, it's God. The temple in Jerusalem, as I've done studies about that and touched on it a little bit without going into great detail, the temple in Jerusalem does what? It sends the message that God became a man, Jesus Christ. And I've done videos about that. God became a man. But what the devil says in his people is that man can become a god. When you take that mark, man becomes a god. You become a beast, unsavable. So if someone is a beast now, they're a freak. They're a creature. It's just like this, as I've mentioned many times. If you took a chicken, God gives a, not a spirit, but a soul. Chicken has a soul. Not a spirit in the image of God, but a soul. A dog has a soul. But if I take a half dog and a half chicken and put it together, what kind of soul would be in it? God didn't create a soul for, you know, half chicken, half dog. He created a soul for each different one. So that's what the devil's doing. That's what's going on when you see this science today, right now. What science is doing, what the Nephilim did, as it tells us in some of these extra-biblical texts, that they corrupted flesh. And that's why in Genesis chapter 6 it said, all flesh was corrupted before the Lord. The flesh was corrupted. God, to preserve his promise to Eve and Adam when he said that your seed will crush the head of the serpent's seed. And God made that promise. The first prophecy in the Bible, Genesis 3:15, that the Messiah would come. A Savior would come. The Christ, Jesus Christ. The devil did everything he could to thwart that coming forth of the seed of a woman. That's Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. So one thing that he did, one of the things that Satan did, was try to corrupt the bloodline of Eve. And how did he do that? By his disciples, his fellow fallen angels, which he was a leader of, they came down and they slept with the daughters of men, just as it says in Genesis chapter 6. And all flesh on the earth became corrupted. But Noah was found righteous in his generation. Noah and his wife and children were saved through the flood. Brothers and sisters, I better cut off because I get into all that and get off on the sidetrack. Because it says in Genesis 6, before and after the flood, there was Nephilim. So as we know, even Goliath, David and Goliath, they had six hands, six fingers, and six toes. When the children of Israel went to the promised land, they were giants in the land. They said, hey, we're like grasshoppers to these people. One grape bunch had to be carried by two men in between them on a big stick. That's how big the grapes were. There was some freaky stuff going on, and science today, inspired by the devil's people, by Satan and demons, are doing the same thing to do. They're creating these Crimeas. They're mixing animals and all this stuff. It's all over the place. Look it up. They want to make super soldiers, all this stuff. That's what's going to the mark of the beast. People talk about the RFID chip. The RFID chip is the development of the technology, but it'll be a mark, like a tattoo. It'll be a mark, not a chip, but a mark. Some kind of a, you know, permanent. You know, that RFID chip can be removed. The mark will be some kind of a permanent marking, like a tattoo thing on people. And it'll have some kind of electronic technology in it, I assume, or whatever. Some kind of a permanent mark. And that thing will change your DNA, and it's going to be unreversible, brothers and sisters. It'll be unreversible. Because if it can be reversible, then of course, then someone can be redeemed. And the Bible tells us when you take the mark, you cannot. You will go to hell. It says it's a promise. Don't take the mark. Profess you're a follower of Jesus Christ. If you're here during the tribulation, you get your head chopped off by the Antichrist. At best, worst case scenario, you'll probably die of starvation or the floods, the famines, the tsunamis, earthquakes, all that stuff. I need to make another video because the Lord gave me a word. And I keep making these long videos. I got a word from the Lord. I need to make a quick one, and it'll probably be the first one that I load.